set the scene. You and me could have been still swimming in lover's dream. Still playing on movie screens. Remember me and set the scene. You and me could have been still swimming in lover's dream. Still playing on movie screen.
Oh, yeah.
Remember me, let's set the scene. You and me could have been still swimming in lover's
dream. Still playing on
movie screen. Remember me, let's set the scene. You and me could have been still swimming in lover's dream. Still playing on movie screen.
Hoe werkt dit? Oh, oké, okay. Hij gaat zo automatisch werken als jouw presentatie aanstaat.
En dan? En dan moet ik maar, wat is gewoon de
volgende? Dan zal hij het wel zeggen, denk ik. Wat
de volgende is deze.
Dat denk ik. Ik denk dat je dan gewoon die kan klikken. Test, test. Good morning, everyone. I would ask of some of you, maybe the ones way in the back, to please come sit in the front. Because I told you, I'm really afraid of silence and I face all these empty chairs. So please, some of you, come and help me. I will come to get you guys, really. I'll really do it. I don't bite. Oh, come on, guys, come on. You get extra points for this, so come on. So, I'm really glad all of you are here, especially after the storm yesterday. So, which of you got stuck in the storm yesterday? Hands up. Oh. And I was wondering if there is a correlation between the study you're taking and if you got stuck. So which architecture students got stuck? Hands up. I would say about 10. Which urban design students got stuck? Okay. And which landscape architect student got stuck? Oh, look, I see a positive. I think you should consider landscape architecture because it seems you are the wisest. So, no, that's just a joke, guys. I'm so glad you came. So last week was about learning about silence. We had different approaches, different lectures, and maybe some of them were a bit crazy, but I hope that you got a first idea of all the many things silence could possibly mean. And now we go on to the second week. So today is quite a long day, but now starts the week of the design assignment. So it's really important you're here because today you'll learn about what is the assignment, you'll learn about the history of the Kop van Java. So pay good attention. First up is Maarten Kloos. Who is Maarten Kloos? He was director of ARCAM and now he is part of the, actually chairman of the committee of Kop van Java, who for about 10 years said, it's the most beautiful spot of Amsterdam, so only the most beautiful plan should be there. And I fully agree with him. So please give the floor to, and a warm applause for Maarten.
Thank you, Sarah, and welcome everyone. I see very sleepy faces, so it's early in the morning and I understand it completely. And that's why I have chosen the formula of kind of a fairy tale. It's just a very beautiful story, I hope, about the Kop Java, which is right behind this building, and the origins of it, especially. So let's start immediately, finding out first. No, which button?
This button?
No. Can you tell me what button? Het bijzondere paaltje. Yes. And this is a slide with which I would like to start. This is a slide. I mean, there's no misunderstanding. Yesterday there was some misunderstanding. Sarah said, is the first slide the right one? Yes, it is the right one, because this is total blackness. total blackness. And the reason I'm showing this this slide is because I talking about the origins of the Java island, it seems appropriate to start with the creation of the world. So we start even long before time existed. It's not even the beginning of the creation, it is before that. This is the moment where you could still wonder whether there would be ever the creation of a world. And then someone who we most of the time we call him God. He invented light. And light was, of course, in the beginning he was a little bit hesitant. So he started very carefully with a little bit of light. And this is what he created. And I think in contrast to total darkness, of total black, he created this, what you could call darkness. And that's what Kester Frerichs is talking about later on. He will talk about darkness. And darkness is absolutely different from total black. Next phase, of course, was this. So God went a little bit further, a little bit more light. And you see here really the beginning of the world. Of course, the Roman Empire to the south, Belgium, which was far ahead of us. And right on top, near top, you see already Java Island. See that? So this is, in European perspective, a beautiful picture of Java Island ages ago. Remember this. When the light was really full grown, you can imagine that God was a little bit disappointed about Holland. Because, of course, when you're creating the world, you would like to create beauty, a beautiful world. And then you think, automatically, I think of huge oceans with volcanoes and the air just covering that beautiful landscape. And you don't think really about marshlands where you only have wet feet and where you can be very, very happy, unhappy. Finding a place to live, finding a place to travel, finding a place to be happy. In this, under these circumstances, we could say that Amsterdam is created. Because in this marshland, more and more people came together and thought, why not live here? In very difficult circumstances, literally drowning now and then, with huge lakes all around a place where maybe it would be possible to create a city. And this is a very early picture of Amsterdam. Very characteristic for this situation is that you see that there is an open connection to the east. Everyone knows that left of the image are dunes which are prohibiting any access to the North Sea. So the access to the North Sea was via the north, via the Zuiderzee, and via the eastern exit of water that we called A. So where you see the word Amsterdam, at the right of the origins of the very beginning of Amsterdam, that is the open A connected with an open connection to the Zuiderzee. And this is extremely important to know, because, for instance, later on, when the city of Amsterdam really got a certain form, and a very convincing form already, you see in the upper right part of the slide, where you read H-E-T, head of head A, you see an empty, completely empty basin. This was the time before there was any of the eastern islands in the harbor of Amsterdam. So once again, you should now you recognize really the city where we are now, where we are living, and working, and you recognize the canals, you recognize the whole character of the city of Amsterdam in the past, in a previous form, previous constellation, and you see the A, where now. We know that there are these islands, these very slender islands. It's still empty. Next phase, and a very important moment, a very crucial moment in the development of Amsterdam, is the digging and building of Noordzeekanaal. And I say in a very explicit way, building the Noordzeekanaal, because of course, if you see this canal, and there are many, many people who think that the whole thing has been dug, but only where you had to go through the dunes, there was really a question of digging a canal. The whole area between the dunes and Amsterdam was a matter of building this canal by filling in the water all around. So here you see the new canal with all the land that has been created to limit this throughway to the dunes and further on to sea. Now what you see here is, and that's why it's such an important moment in the history of Amsterdam, is a complete reversal of the city. Amsterdam used to be a city with a harbor exit in the east, and now it got a harbor exit to the west. So what I always tell with this story is that you really should imagine that at the end of the 19th century, there has been a moment at which future widows of seamen stood waving to the east, and suddenly next day they had to start waving to the west. Imagine that, the whole city turned around. And this was the first time that this happened in Amsterdam. Later on, in connection to what you see here, there were still many other moments on which processes in the city of Amsterdam, within the Amsterdam city, were replaced from the east to the west. We could talk about that later, but maybe this is sufficient for right now. In the course of these processes, there was the building of Java Island in the eastern basin of the Ei. So here you see the sluices at the eastern end, near Zeeburger Island, and you recognize Java Island. And there's one thing that you notice immediately, especially you probably, that is that what we call Kop Java Island, right from the beginning, has been empty. There has never been built something on the Kop of Java Island. I'll explain it later on. But here you see that the eastern basin of the A is really practically full. I mean, you see Borneo Spoorweg, what we call Borneo Spoorweg right now. You see KNSM and you see Java Island, and on top you see a reservation for the depot of mud and so on. So you see that it's an area which is fully used, and where very little water space finally remains. Important slide this. Important. You see it right here too. And you see practically the same thing, because north of Java Island, you see the outlines of the same area that I called a depot in the previous slide. But here you see, of course, the future constellation that Van Eesteren, the urbanist Van Eesteren, and his colleagues thought out for the city of Amsterdam. So you see here this very famous finger model with green areas in between housing areas, which are green areas that are really penetrating very deeply into the city. You see the western garden cities to the west, you see Buitenveldert in the south, and so on. And in the north, around Eye, you see especially important infrastructure suggestions anyway. So you see at Zeeburg, where at this moment there's a huge building activity, you see this airplane drone, and you see the wide reservation for a canal all around the north of Amsterdam, a canal that never has been built. But this is still, the layout of the city as a point of departure for planning in Amsterdam. And to, if you look at this more in detail, you see here once again you see this huge barrier that's that central station with the islands to the west and to the east are. And you see very clearly Java Island, where right now you recognize what I said about the railway tracks over there. The kop is empty and is practically only there to guarantee the shunting of trains from one side to the other. So here you also understand why Java Island has been built. First as a breakwater and then as a real peninsula, and very slender to have the maximum of length of the quays connected to the necessity of making it possible that trains could reach the boats. And trains got longer and longer at the end of the 19th century, and boats became longer and longer and longer. So you needed very, very long islands that could be very, very slender. Another, what you see here is that already you can predict, you could have predicted future changes. So here it is maybe interesting to point out and to speak of another of those inversions that reversals of that that I was talking about before. If you look at Central Station, for instance, and you see the Eastern Island where the word station is mentioned, that's of course nowadays Osterdok Island, which has been transformed completely. Why could it be transformed? Because all kinds of services that were related to railway were in a later stage, and not so long ago, related to motor transport, and could be transferred, in this case, to the western area. So, for instance, the distribution offices of the Dutch post has been transferred from this Oosterdok Island to the west. Another example where you have see this east-west transformation. The same is true, of course, for Java Island, because for a very long time it has functioned, basically until the 50s of last century. And then, especially provoked, of course, by the decolonization of Indonesia, the trade with the Far East was let's say, ruined, more or less. And Java Island and also Kadenzeeland Island lost their functions, so to say. This meant that from that moment on, many buildings on this island, which form Java Island and Kadenzeeland together, many buildings either were empty. Later on, they were squatted. There were artists and urban nomads sitting in those places for a very, very long time, and a very, very long time, mainly because it took the authorities in Amsterdam a very, very long time to consider and to think what to do with these islands. This is remarkable, but it's also important because it at the end it appeared to be very, very fruitful. You all know that it took years and years to find out what the future of these islands could be. And there you should know, for instance, that already right after the war, it was absolutely clear that the harbor activities in the Eastern Basin would lose their importance whatsoever, and that the Western Harbor area would be the real main activity for the port of Amsterdam. So already since the 50s, really early 50s, people knew that you could do something in the Eastern Basin of the A, but nobody had the faintest idea. And you could say after realizing both Java Island and Kaan Zemme and finally Borneo Spoor, you could say that the thinking had its importance, because finally very interesting new schemes were invented and were realized on these two islands. Now, speaking of Java Island, it was in the 90s that this whole island was completely demolished. So everything that was there, except one building in the north, not in the north, but in the east, but in top of the slide. You see the island here completely empty, but basically with the form of the island completely untouched. And this was done to build, of course, this scheme by Sjoerd Soeters. Now this, I'm not going to explain it, you all know it, and you know it probably very, very well. What you see in this scheme, which is a very, very early drawing by Soeters, is remarkable. The bridge is already there. It's not a bridge by Ton Vanhoven, but it is a bridge like that, more or less. So we are at the left end of the right now in this room. We are at the left end of the bridge, and remarkably, you see that at the Kop of Kop Java, you see a park. And in another form, in an alternative sketch of this plan, it's still more bizarre because there is a canal between the Kop and the island, which you will find later on in the actual ideas. But instead of a park, there a huge series of tall high-rise buildings has been drawn. So in this stage of the planning for Java Island, there was already the complete idea for the parcellation and so on, and the canals in of the main so-called mainland, but for the Kop, the Kop has been taken completely apart from the Soeters scheme, and so you see that when the housing, practically all the housing is realized, the hotel is under construction here, and you see this. The Kop as it is now, with this school, which is the temporary solution for the Kop. Now you should imagine that it is the year 2000. It's year 2000, and at that moment, the older man, Duco Stader, it was Duco Stader, you could say another god after the first god that created the world. The second god was Duco Stader, and he said something had to be found out. We have to decide on Kop Java Island. That was the moment that at Arkham we said, this is the most beautiful spot in the world. Here you should only realize the best and the most magnificent project in the world. So we sent a kind of open call to every Amsterdammer, saying, give us your ideas, give us suggestions, say what you think that would be done at Kop Java Island. And we got some 100 projects. We made an exhibition. There were two discussions that year. And this is an example of what an Amsterdamer unknown to me thought about it. This was an idea, and the most spectacular one. This was an idea. So, whatever you are going to figure out these days, this has been done already. Yeah, yeah. So, it's clear that at the end of this discussion, at the end of this exhibition, everything was published, etc., etc. And it was clear that the best project in the world was not among the ideas that were proposed. So, this de Costader took a very, very important decision. He suggested, and the city council accepted this, he said, let's speak of a kind of moratorium for 10 years. We decide that during 10 years, no project whatsoever will be realized on Kop Java Island. Interesting situation. So you could say that for years, there was some kind of a void. No one was speaking about Kop Java Island. It was just not done because, why should you? There was no possibility whatsoever to do something at Kop Java Island. But then after some seven years, you could say there was a kind of pressure, there was a kind of tension. I mean, 10 years, a moratorium of 10 years, it was acceptable that people started to think, oh, wow, it's within 3 years, we can start again. We can start again thinking about it. So the third god, Maarten van Poelgeest, he came to me and he said, what shall we do? I mean, there are people coming to me with ideas. They're sending me their projects and so on and so on and so on. It was then that I suggested you should appoint a committee that will help you, that will protect you also. Imagine a committee that's there, and every time you get a plan, you never ask for plans, but you get it by the post, or you find it on your desk in the morning, and you think what to do with this plan, you send it to this committee. And the committee has only one task, very, very, you could say a very strict task. The only task was to find out whether the project that was sent by whatever architect or building promoter, if this project is the best project in the world. And this committee was appointed. He had one condition, that I would be the chairman. So I have been the chairman since 2008 of a very, very interesting committee with a former advisor on the landscape, Ietje Fettes, for instance, with the director of the Academy of Architecture, first Art Oxenaar, now Madeleine. Madeleine Maaskant, and then I'm thinking still of other names, but only very important people who know Amsterdam very, very well, and with whom we came together, let's say, once or twice a year to see, are there new projects proposed, and what shall we say about them? And to give you an impression, I did very, very quickly here. This is a series of images, a selection, quite a very small selection of projects that have been proposed for Kop Java. And this is the art city. Yes, this is an artwork. This is, of course, a housing tower. And I don't mention the names of the architects to protect them. This is, of course, this is the. This is inspired by the small windmills that you buy on Damrak in the souvenir shops. And there was, in fact, one idea about that DRO, what's now Ruimte en Duurzaamheid, the city of Amsterdam, proposed, just to give a suggestion, and so on and so on. So these are and I could show more and more of these images, but I leave it here because then, only a couple of years ago, the discussion focused completely on a bridge to the north, or first of all the phenomenon to build one or more bridges between Amsterdam South, between the city center and Amsterdam North. But in a rather early stage already, it was clear that whenever there would have been there would be a question of building a bridge to the north, that Java Island, from Java Island, it was one of the first places to do this. But to be short, at this moment there is the idea. I mean, the decision that was taken was, we are going to investigate the possibilities of building a bridge between Java Island and the north of Amsterdam as the start of a process during which maybe one or maybe two bridges could be added later on. So the accent in the discussion about a bridge, yes or no, focused very, very quickly on the this spot, the Spits, the spot that we still call Kop Java Eiland. And I must say there were already ideas earlier, before the Sprong, but ideas that literally took this the Sprong, the so-called Sprong, the jump to north, as a starting point. So these were the ideas that were living. The discussion about the bridge, and for the first time in seven, eight years, we had to accept that it's very probable that the Kop Java Eiland will be the place from where a bridge to the north will start, so to say. And that was the moment that we also thought, this is the first time that we are overruled, more or less, in a very natural way. Well, I mean, it's no problem whatsoever, but the decision whether to build a bridge or not at Java Eiland, that was absolutely something about which we, as a committee, couldn't decide. This was the city at a higher level that decided. So we had to rethink in a way, suggesting, for instance, or thinking about the possibility, what if a bridge will be there? And that made that we immediately looked again at Java Eiland in a much larger context. And we noticed that this finger model of the city is still there, that within this, the constellation of Amsterdam, with building accents, especially around in the periphery, and especially in the ring zone, all around the A10, that you see this model more or less with the accent, large accent on the possibilities of building a green metropole. We got publications like this. Here you see it. And then we noticed another other thing, that all around the A, in the upper part of the slide, you see A Centraal, and you see the high-rise development near Oosterhoeks. Oosterhoeks, zeg ik het goed? Overhoeks, ja. And you see in the middle, you see Kaanse Eiland, of course, Java Eiland, and you see the Sluisbuurt on Zeeburg in the lower part of the slide. So what we thought is that if in a city where space is scarce, where you have to be very, very critical about building non-built space, that, and you see this, you see that the A and all the possibilities around A are used to make to build as intensely as possible, as high as possible in Sluisbuurt, for instance, but also over Hoeks. It is, if you combine this with the idea of a green metropole, with the idea that to make a sustainable city, you absolutely need to create open green spaces, etc., etc. It was the moment, of course, that we looked with a different eye again at Kopjava Eiland, and that we remembered previous ideas about leaving the place open and making kind of a park. Something that you immediately think about at that moment, but let's say constantly, is that this could be a picture of the future, where I must add immediately that the bridge that you see here is that's shown between Kopjava and the north, and on the left side of the this is a bridge that absolutely can't be built. So forget that build, but look at this idea that Kopjava Island, whenever a bridge is built, will be a kind of place of transition between the city center and the north. At this moment, Kopjava is more or less the end of the world, but it will be a place which is where you can stop for a moment, going from where we are, the Zwijger, to Java Eiland, resting a little bit, and then go further on to the north, to the Hamerkwartier in Amsterdam North. So the position of the island, which always has been there, is getting different and is changing absolutely. And of course this is important, because as when you look at the island, I mean, this is how you see the island, the Kop, from it's a picture taken from a boat. You see that it is not very visible in the city. It is, and even if you're a little bit lower on the boat, you don't see the Kop, absolutely not. So it's rather still rather anonymous, and yet it is incredibly anchored in history. For instance, this is an ancient picture of Java. So right in front you see the Kop of Java Island, and this is a beautiful drawing by Sigrid van Essel, where she emptied the Ei, and where you see on both sides of Java Island, you see the so-called Oergeul, this is the very, very the deepest soil, deepest trench of the Ei. This is really, really old, and so on. And all that made that we advised the next god, Erik van den Burg, to say, let's take the decision and say the whole Kop, which is the green area here, will be a park. Now, to explain this, you should know two things. You see two bridges drawn in this drawing. Both of them are being investigated. I mean, there's research is going on to find out what is the best bridge, what is the most acceptable bridge, which is and which is maybe a bridge that absolutely can't be there. So the orange bridge is a proposal that we absolutely prefer as a committee, that also this alderman Erik van den Burg prefers, but it's not yet absolutely not yet sure whether this thing will be built or not. The only thing, and that's why it's important to take this this drawing as a starting point, is that you should realize that basically from now on this whole slender island will be a park in which a bridge has to land. Second thing is where you see Nieuwe Gracht, and you see that this now the Kop is really cut. There's a cut between the main Java Island and the island. This canal is absolutely going to be there whenever a bridge is built, to make it possible that boats with high masts, with tall masts, will be able to pass the place in a very easy way and a very smooth way. So you get compared to what you see right now at Java Island, you get an island which is a little bit more slender than the place right now, isolated from Java Island by this canal, and in the future, probably connected to the north by one of these bridges. And then again, it is amusing to see that this is This is what in one of the previous states, Sjoerd Soeters already so designed. So it took really it took some 20 years to protect Java Island against all those high rise things and so on, and to accept that this is or something like this is a nice thing. The open call to Amsterdamers, one of the projects I didn't show just before, is a walled garden, and miraculously already isolated from the island by this canal, even without the bridge. Now this is more or less the situation right now, and you all know, of course, that whenever there's an empty place in the city, and especially in Amsterdam. There's an incredible noise. There's visual noise. There's acoustic noise. There's I don't know if you recognize the place, but this is Kopjava. During sale and during an incredible festive program of that year, and this is of course the place that is suggested right now. It's green. And moreover, there is the last god that I would like to present. And this time, of course, it is a goddess. It's a goddess, it's a female god that says, that's absolutely taken in for silence. We have a god of silence. She's called Sarah. And Sarah is going to explain why images like this and this atmosphere in which you should be very, very silent. That you should remember this.
Thank you so much, Maarten. That was really, really interesting. I'm sure you have a lot of questions for him, but because I want to explain quickly the design assignment and then give you a break. Maybe you can ask questions in the break, or he'll be around later also. I really like the idea of the Java Island as a mythical place with all these gods, I have to say. That's a new new way to look at it. Oh, now we're going backwards. I don't know how. Ah, yeah, there we go. So I'll take you really briefly through the design assignment, and of course, if there's things unclear, you can always ask me later, because I have about 5 minutes, but I think that should be okay. So, to sum things up, I say silence needs to be designed, or else you may lose it. But is it true? You guys decide, it's up to you. So my statement is for the Kop van Java, maybe the thing we need to design there is not built, perhaps. Perhaps we need to design a silence, but how? I'm looking to all of you to come up with great ideas and amaze me. So, as Maarten already pointed to, I have a few conditions. There will be a canal. That's where, I don't know if there's a, is there a pointer on this thing? Huh? Oh, okay, it's very clear. Well, that's always nice. So there is a canal, we call it Mastenroute, because it's the masts of these boats that are too high to pass under a bridge. But I say not only if there's a bridge, there will be a canal anyway. So in your design, please make a canal like I show on the image. Consider the neighbors. So it's always maybe wise to consider the neighbors. The white block there is the hotel. It's already built, so please incorporate it in your design as a given. But then what more neighbors are there? After the break, we have a talk by Anneke Blokker and by Kester Freeriks about the surroundings. Yeah, so maybe if you want silence, you need to be friends with your neighbors also. And where actually does the Kop van Java end? You could say it's the land, like we see here. But maybe it's also the Ei. Yeah? The Ei River, as we saw in the beautiful image of the Droge Ei, is very deep also. And if you want darkness, maybe the whole city should be dark. So please consider the neighbors. Then, as Maarten also said, there will be a connection. The, let's say the main favorite theory now is of a bridge. So you could imagine a bridge, but it's not a given. If you really feel the connection should be in a different way, it's maybe a little less realistic, but if you convince me, just tell me why, tell me how. But for now, there's two ideas for the bridge. So for instance, this one, or it could also be there. And like Maarten said, there has to be a point in this canal where the bridge can really open for the high boats to pass through if you want to design a bridge. So summing things up, there will be a canal. Do consider the neighbors. There will be a connection, but where? And maybe how? So what is silence? I don't know. I'm supposed to be the god of silence, but true gods always leave it up to the people to say what is silence. So summing things up, we've seen a lot of different looks. We've seen the silent university, a very political view of silence. Maybe an artist who said, I challenge the idea of silence as a passive state. So the man who is silent is definitely not saying nothing. I find that very interesting personally. Then we saw on the right, psychiatrist Pelle, who always has this gaze, and I want to tell him everything. But he deals with people who really are troubled by loud sounds and who look for silence in the city. Then we have the idea of nature in the middle, beautiful painting by Caspar David Friedrich, of the romantic notion that in this busy city we need a place of quiet. And then there is on the right the silent disco, probably you all know it. And on the left, the anti-drone tent, the data silence that maybe yesterday we heard a little bit about in Bits of Freedom. So what is silence and do we need it? Up to you, but I want a good story. So summing things up again, perhaps the Kop van Java is Amsterdam's largest empty spot and its broadest viewpoint. Consider the context. Think three-dimensional. The sky is high, the view is wide, and the Ei is deep. And this is the, well, very beautiful view from the Kop of Java. So the location is not just the location, but maybe also the potential, how it makes you feel. And then finally, perhaps the silence doesn't need to be built, guys. I know it's scary to say this to all of you builders, but consider the immaterial architecture also. So this thing is my artwork, my letter to the neighbors, asking them to pay that portion of my rent they were taking up in my home with their noise. And so maybe part of your design can be immaterial. Maybe you want to change the law. Maybe you want to involve the neighbors. Maybe, you know, something else. Amaze me. What form do I want your presentation to take? We ask 1A3 in landscape with 280 characters, your thought. To me, that's maybe the most important part. And it's a bit scary for you guys, I know, because it's a sentence. Eh? It's what you think. It's not, in that sense, visual. It's the current Twitter maximum, so I think that should be sufficient. Tell me what you think this silence for Kop van Java should be. Then I ask 1A0 in portrait with your plan. Well, you all know about that. And then, to support your plan, I ask one three-dimensional object. I made a kind of funny drawing. What do I mean? I really mean one three-dimensional object. So, of course, we have a nice pedestal for you to put it on. You're allowed, totally allowed, to make a little maquette, a little, like the thing I tried to draw. But you could also say, you know, anything goes. So an iPad, for me, any kind of isn't 3D object. That's fine. What did I draw? Any kind of object, a candle, a brick, even a dinosaur. Only please, it needs to really support your plan. So think about what additional object supports my plan the best and make it count. Thank you, guys. Now there's a short break, and at 10:15, we will start with a lecture by Kester Freeriks on the dark sky movement and Anneke Blokker on ecology. Hope to see you soon.
much to tell. Out of sight, out of mind.